Good afternoon. So today we have a very special occasion to have with us Professor Sushmita Mitra from Indian Statistical Institute. I would like to introduce Professor Sushmita Mitra. She is a full professor at the Machine Intelligence Unit, Indian Statistical Institute, Kolkata. Machine Intelligence Unit was created by Professor Sankar Pal some years ago. The inside of the Indian Statistical Institute, you can imagine how you can create Machine Intelligence Unit inside of Statistical Institute in Poland. Oh, this is not true. But the Indian Statistical Institute's name is a large campus just in Kolkata. Together with physics, with other departments, also computer science, and they have several divisions around the countries. So Professor Sankar was also the main director for several years of this institute. So and the Professor Sushmita Mitra is working with him and also struggling for many years, I think. Yes. She is now the head of Machine Intelligence Unit. Yes. And it was during the period of 2010-2012. From 92 to 94, she was in Aachen, in Technical University of Aachen, Germany, as a fellow of DAAD. She was a visiting professor in computer science of the University of Alberta, Edmonton, Canada in 2004 and 2007, Meiji University in Japan 1999, 2004, 2005, 2007, Aalborg University, Denmark in 2002, 2003, and she received National Talent Search Scholarship in 1978-83 from CERT India, and the University Gold Medal in 1988, the IEEE-DMN Outstanding Paper Award for the pioneering work in Euro-fuzzy computing, and also the UNESCO Fellowship in 1996. She is IEEE CIC Distinguished Lecturer for the period 2014 and 2016. And on the basis of this, she is in Poland. So this is really a great pleasure. So you see a lot of European countries even, and not so often in Poland so far. So should this improve? She is the author of the books Neurofuzzy Pattern Recognition, Methods in Soft Computing and Data Mining, Multimedia, Soft Computing and Bioinformatics, published by Wiley, and also Introduction to Machine Learning and Bioinformatics, Chapman and Hall, CRC Press, beside the host of other edited book. She was working as a guest editor of special issues, several journals, and associate editor of IEEE AC and Transactions of Computational Paleology and Bioinformatics, Information Sciences, Neurocomputing, and the founding associate editor of Wiley Interdisciplinary Reviews, Data Mining and Knowledge Discovery. She has more than 75 research publications in referred international journals. According to the Science Citation Index, two of her papers have been ranked 3rd and 15th in the list of top cited papers in engineering science from India during the period 1992-2001. So it is not so easy as in Poland because, you know, India has only something like more than 1 billion of people. So. Professor Mitra is also a fellow of IEEE, a fellow of the Indian National Academy of Engineering and the National Academy of Science in India. Shrinks IEEE CIC Distinguished Lecturer for the period I mentioned before. She has served in the capacity of Program Chair, Tutorial Chair, Plenary Speaker, and as PC member of many international conferences. And her current research interests include data mining, pattern recognition, soft computing, including fileset and RAFSET, image processing, and bioinformatics. It's not written here, but she's also a very nice person, very good friend of Poland and of us, and so Professor Sushmita Mitrajewa, very welcome in Poland, and as a project you will visit us more often, and now the floor is yours.
A very good afternoon to everybody. It is my great pleasure to be here in Poland on the first of my IEEE-sponsored distinguished lectures. So, in this visit to Poland, which was made possible firstly through Chris, who is sitting here, IEEE chair for the local chapter of computational intelligence in Poland, and of course Professor Andrzej Skowron, who is a good friend for many years, and also Professor Khalid Said, who was in Krakow. So I had two lectures during this visit. The first one was at Krakow last Friday, and this is my great pleasure to be delivering today's talk here in Warsaw, in the University of Warsaw. The title of the talk is Hybridization with RAFSETs, and I understand that people here are experts in RAFSETs, so I have intentionally skipped certain details, preliminary details of RAFSETs, which I understand will be very boring to you, but I have focused on the hybridization with the other soft computing techniques that we have been carrying out over the last decade in our institute, and with some of the recent applications we have made in bioinformatics and biomedical imagery. We were first introduced to RAFSETs by Dr. Mohua Banerjee, whom most of you must be knowing. She was visiting our department she was working with Professor Shankar Pal, and I had the opportunity of interacting with her, and one of the pioneering papers in neurofuzzy and RAF hybridization was designed at that time. So with that, we started working on hybridization with RAF sets. So the talk will be organized as follows. First, I'll give a very short introduction to RAF sets, and then to its hybridization and its applications to knowledge encoding, classification, clustering, as well as in bioinformatics, face recognition, and biomedical imaging. So this is how work started in computational intelligence in India, particularly in our institute. Our institute was one of the pioneers. So the work on fuzzy sets started in 1975 when Professor Shankar Pal started his PhD work. And then my PhD work was on neurofuzzy hybridization, which started around 1990. I was one of the first PhD students of Professor Pal. And of course, RAF sets were introduced by Professor Pawlak in Poland, your very own Warsaw. And we tried to integrate it as a new component in the computational intelligence framework in this pioneering paper with MoMA. And then the Center for Soft Computing Research, a National Institute of Excellence, was founded in ISI in 2005, and I am also a co-founder of that institute. Uh, to the preliminaries of rough sets, which I'll make very short. So as you know, all of you know, it is a major mathematical tool for managing uncertainty that arises from granularity in the domain of discourse due to the indiscernibility between objects in a set, and we approximate a given concept from below and from above using the lower and upper approximations. And these approximations are defined through the information provided by the selected attributes. So depending on the completeness of the attributes or availability of features, the roughness diminishes. So this is the basic picture characterizing the upper and lower approximation. And with the availability of more and more information, the rough region between the lower and upper approximation diminishes. While in the crisps, in the ideal case, with all information available, the rough set approaches the crisp set with no roughness remaining. So this is a very preliminary mathematical representation in terms of upper and lower approximation. I just speed up through these slides because, of course, it's a repetition for all of you. Rough sets mainly help in discovering redundancies and dependencies between the features of a problem to be classified, and is found to be very useful in knowledge discovery in databases, particularly data mining. And it offers mathematically established tools to discover hidden patterns in the data, and it has been used for knowledge extraction in the form of rules in event form from crude domain knowledge using decision table. So, that can be used for encoding knowledge-based networks. So as you know, we have artificial neural networks. So the first work that we did in rough sets, hybridization, was in encoding the artificial neural networks. The topology of the neural network was initialized using the event rules extracted by rough sets. The crude domain knowledge was used to encode the initial topology of the network. Thereby, we could start from a better point in the search space so that convergence could be faster. So there can be two major approaches to the design using rough sets. One is the set-based based on decision tables, and then the distance-based, which is related to clustering. So we have used both the approaches in some of our works. So in decision tables, the same or indiscernible objects may be represented several times. The indiscernible objects may have different decisions, that is, they can be inconsistent, and some of the attributes may be superfluous. So in data mining or in dimensionality reduction particularly, you need to find out these superfluous attributes, and rather find out redux, which are the minimal set of attributes which are essential to arrive at a decision. So for knowledge extraction using rough sets, we use the decision table approach. We remove some of the undesirable attributes and analyze the data dependency in the reduced database to find the minimal subset of attributes which you call redux. And this is somewhat analogous to the primary key in the database. Whereas in the clustering approach, in the cluster-based approach, a pattern can belong, in the rough clusters, a pattern can belong to at most one lower approximation if it is very close to it, based on certain threshold values. Or it can be a member in a lower approximation. If it is a member of a lower approximation, it is also a member of the corresponding upper approximation. However, in the other case, if the pattern does not belong to any one lower approximation, then it must belong to two or more upper approximations. So this is the cluster-based approach, the definition according to that. It is somewhat analogous to fuzzy clusters, but it's different in the sense here you are defining in terms of approximations, there in terms of membership. So if this is an unknown object pattern and these are the two existing clusters, so if it is closest to this cluster, then, and this is second closest to this second cluster V1, then if the difference between these two distances is less than a threshold, then we say that these two cluster centers are very close to the unknown pattern and it should belong to the upper approximation of both the clusters. However, if the distance to the closest center is very low and the distance to the second closest cluster is rather high, that means the difference in distance is greater than this threshold, which is user defined of course, then we say that it belongs to this closest cluster only. Then it is assigned to the lower and upper approximation of U2. So, distinguish between the fuzzy and rough approaches, in fuzzy set, the uncertainty in the overlapping regions is modeled by membership values based on similarity relations, whereas in rough sets, the uncertainty is due to the granularity from the indiscernibility modeled by lower and upper approximations. So here, with the absence of, with the availability of more and more information, the ambiguity may be reached. So the ambiguity is more due to the absence of complete information. So the two approaches are different in this manner, whereas both are ways to model uncertainty. So with that brief introduction, we move on to the hybridization and some of the applications that we have undertaken. So first, to knowledge encoding, that was one of our first applications and approaches to hybridization, then followed by classification, then feature selection, clustering, with some applications. Well, this was the pioneering integration for knowledge encoding using the discernibility function, redux and dependency rules. So the hybridization of rough sets was made with neurocomputing for mining the initial topology of the knowledge-based subnetworks, as I discussed earlier. So if you initialize the topology in a, with proved domain knowledge, you start from a better point in the search space and you converge faster. And fuzzy sets was used at the input and output layer of the multi-layer perceptron, in terms of linguistic inputs and overlapping class membership. And the redux were computed to correspond to the minimal feature sets, thereby we were able to generate smaller subnetworks which were more meaningful for extracting refined rules at a later stage. For example, for this crude data, this is a crude representation of this pattern set, and a sample rule that was extracted using rough sets, let us say, was we divided each attribute into three linguistic features, low, medium and high. So this square, this granule corresponded to the rule M1 and M2, that is medium for feature 1 and medium for feature 2. So this was the crude representation, the inner square representing this set, which was later defined in the neurofuzzy framework. So this is an example of the rule that we generated. So there were six classes in this particular application. It was a Bhavel data set of an Indian language, which is Telugu, a South Indian language. So there are six vowels, O, A, E, U, A, O. These were the six vowels, and this is the example represented from the sixth class. So this was the sample rule extracted, which was reduced to form this, logically reduced. And there were different redux, and the different redux gave rise to these three rules. So we had 1, 2, and 3 rules for class 6. Similarly, for the other 5 classes, we obtained a set of 1, set of 2, set of 1, set of 1, and set of 2 rules for the other 5 classes. And the dependency factor was computed to be 1. So, by combining all the classes together, we could generate 3 into 2 into 2, that is 12 sets of dependency rules for the 6 classes. So, we could generate 12 subnetworks. 12 sets of subnetworks for the entire problem. which were subsequently combined. So the role of rough sets here was that the network topology was automatically determined from the dependency rules generated from the decision tables by computing relative redux, and the dependency factors were encoded as the initial condition rates. So the network topology was generated from the AND/OR form of the rules, and the dependency factors were used for determining the values of the connection rates. And the feature space or output classes provide the condition or decision attributes of the decision table. The hidden nodes model the conjuncts in the antecedent part of the rule, while the output nodes model the disjuncts. And here is an example demonstrating the rule encoding. So let us consider the first rule for class 1. So since there are 6 classes, we have 6 output nodes, and in none of these rules, so of the 12 subnetworks that I mentioned earlier, this is one subnetwork. So in this we find there are no conjuncts, so each output node is directly connected to the hidden node with the dependency factor 1. This is the initial connection weight value. And for the first rule we see it is C1. C1 is represented as the H1 and L2 and L3. So it is connected to H1, it is connected to L2, and it is connected to L3. And this dependency factor is getting percolated into three directions. So it is 1/3, 1/3, 1/3. So this is the initial connection rate. This is how we encode the initial connection rate. So this holds for all the 6 classes. So this is the initial representation of the subnetwork. So in normal neural networks, you start with absolutely random topology, random weight values. Here we are using rough sets to start from a better position. So with that network, we used it for classification. So with that initial topology formulation, that was the first paper with Momoa involved, and then we moved on to hybrid classification. It was a generic application from that. So this was with another scholar we had. He is now a faculty in IIT Kharagpur, that is Pavitra Mitra. So this was published in 2003. So we used the same formulation. Now, to split a learning task into several subtasks, train a subnetwork for each subtask, integrate the subnetworks to generate the final solution. So the strategy was divide and conquer, and thereby it could be applied to mining large data sets. And in addition to rough and neuro and fuzzy, we introduced the genetic component into the computational intelligence framework. Here we could obtain effective scaling of the algorithm, it speeded up convergence, improved generalization. It was able to generate compact set of meaningful and less redundant rules. That means since the structure of the network was more compact, there was less redundancy, so we could extract better and more refined rules. And the final network had more structured components. That is, it was fast but stronger connections. So that during extraction of refined rules, the rules were more meaningful. So here what we did was split an L class problem into L2 class problems, and then we trained pools of subnetwork modules for each of the 2 class problems. So for each, suppose we had 6 classes, that means the first problem would be whether belonging to class 1 or 2 or not to class 1. Again the second would be belonging to class 2 or not to class 2. Thereby we had L2 class subnetworks, and they were concatenated, and ultimately instead of backpropagation as in multilayer perceptron, we use genetic algorithm to evolve the subnetworks, the concatenated subnetworks. So we were using rough sets to encode the crude domain knowledge, and we were using genetic algorithm to evolve the smaller subnetworks together, and ultimately we were able to extract better rules, as we will demonstrate with the results. And the the subnetwork I depicted a few slides earlier, you find that the initial topology was set, but then these are the intramodular links. So these are already set by the RAPSET concept. So these were left unchanged with a lower mutation, and the intermodular links, that is between the subnetworks when you concatenate, those were given higher mutation so that they could be adapted more during the genetic evolution. So the schematically the representation is as follows. So we have the fuzzy sets at the input, the linguistic input, the output class membership, the RAP sets were used to formulate the initial topology of the network and also the connection rate values, and GA was used at the global level to tune the membership at the input and output as well as the connection rates and the topology. So this was the broad framework for this work. So schematically what happens is, this is the pictorial representation. I don't go into the mathematical details because these are all available in these papers. So in this particular paper, we used it for, we had a project on cervical cancer diagnosis with a hospital in Kolkata. So this is how the model was evolved. So you see once, so there were two classes, let us say. So initially what happens is, when you use RAPSET to enforce the domain knowledge, you have this crude representation. Then you have the partially defined subnetworks using GA within the subnetworks. So they get evolved. So you get a more generalized representation. And finally, when these networks are concatenated together, these subnetworks are concatenated together, and then again you use GA with the variable mutation operator such that the intra network links are not mutated so much, they have a low mutation probability, whereas the inter network links are mutated with a higher probability, and thereby you get more generalized representation of the classes. So this is how it works. The representation is provided figuratively. So this is some of the results we obtained with this rough classification. See, so these are the generic development of the models. So this is the MLP, fuzzy MLP, then the rough fuzzy MLP, and then this modular approach with the genetic algorithm involved. So thereby the classification performance of the training set and the test set was found to be better. Here the network size was less in terms of the number of links, and the training time as measured in terms of the time spent, the CPU time, here also it was found to be less. So this sort of hybridization was found to result in better performance. So this was the data actually that I mentioned about the six vowel classes. This is represented in two dimensions just for ease of depiction. Actually in three dimensions, this was one of the preliminary data sets we in ISI we used very often in those times. So these were the final refined extracted rules for each of these classes. So for example, for delta class, that is O, this is here, it was M1 or M2, M1 or M2, the third dimension is not given here, with a certainty factor which was computed in this manner, based on the connection rate value and the threshold. So the certainty factor which measures the confidence of the link. This is the refined extracted rules. So with that, then we moved to, we did something on using redux with genetic algorithms optimization for feature selection, and we applied it to microarray gene expression data. Now, why do we need feature selection? Because in microarray gene expression data, as you may be aware, it has got a very large number of genes, the data that is obtained publicly from the internet. The numeric values are obtained publicly. So we use that because it is very difficult to get actual data from the wet labs. We are trying always, of course, but it is a very difficult problem. So this was done on some of the publicly available databases. So here the number of genes is often very, very large, whereas the number of samples is very less. So it's a sort of a skewed representation, and most of the genes are redundant. So you have to get rid of many of the useless genes. So we need feature selection, which is very important. So for that we use RAF sets, the redux concept, to reduce the number of attributes. And because a large number of redundant genes can also degrade the classification or clustering performance by masking the contribution of the relevant features. So it becomes even more important to remove the less important genes. So we use graph sets and multi-objective genes. Why? Because the redux in graph set theory correspond to the minimal feature sets necessary and sufficient to represent the correct classification decision. Redux can classify among all elements of the universe with the same accuracy as the starting attribute set and our smaller cardinality. So redux are very useful. So we use the redux concept of RAF sets. And we use multi-objective optimization. Why? Because the two objectives were of conflicting nature. When they are of conflicting nature, we need to use multi-objective optimization, because you see, when you reduce the number of features, the performance tends to go down. But what we need is, we want to reduce the number of features while we want to improve the classification performance. So these are two contradictory criteria, and so multi-objective optimization becomes very important, and hence we use multi-objective GA. So this was again a work with Moha Banerjee and with my student Haidar Banka, who is now my PhD student. Now he is a faculty in Indian School of Mines in Thangal. So this was published in 2007. So here the solutions were of the problem were represented as binary strings of length n, where n is the number of condition attributes or the genes, whether the gene was present or absent. If it is absent, we represent it by 0, that means that gene is no more there. So 1 or 0 indicates the presence or absence of the corresponding attribute. And LB is the number of 1s in the redux candidate, that means the number of genes present in the redux candidate. The number of objects which can be discerned between, that is CB. And the number of objects in the two classes are M1 and M2. Let us say that initially, we considered two classes, so that's why I am explaining this concept with the help of a very small problem to explain the thing with an example. And there we considered there are M1 and M2 objects in the two classes. And there are n number of attributes, of which the number of attributes present in the redux is n. So the first objective function, F1, is defined in this manner, so that if you have less attributes, LB is lower, that means the whole value is higher. So F1 is higher when there are less attributes in the redux. Similarly, the second objective function refers to the classification performance, which is the number of pairs of objects it is able to distinguish between. So the higher the classification accuracy, the higher the value of the numerator here, and the higher the value of F2. M1 and M2 are used for normalization. M1 is the number of objects in class 1, number of objects in class 2. So these are the two contradictory objective functions, because we want to have a higher value of F1, that means a lower size or lower number of genes, and we want to have a higher classification accuracy, so a higher value of F2. Now, we could have used a single objective function, as in a single objective genetic algorithm, but then we would have to use a composite function F as alpha 1 F1 and alpha 2 F2, where again alpha 1 and alpha 2 would have to be user defined. So when you use multi-objective optimization, we can get rid of these alpha 1, alpha 2 parameters, which again are user defined. So with that in mind, we use multi-objective GA for optimizing the problem. So this is a toy example to demonstrate the computation. So here let us say that there are 8 attributes in all. So this is a sample string. Now there are M1 objects in class, there are two objects in class 1 and three objects in class 2. That is, M is 3 and M is 2. That's why this is M1, 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 M2, M1, M2, M2, and M2, M3. So these are the six object pairs between the two classes. And this is the 8 set of genes or attributes present. For this sample string, we have three attributes having value 1. That is, LD is 3 and CV is 5. Why? Because this is a distinction table, which is a Lakset concept. And in distinction table, a 1 indicates that this pair of objects is being discerned. So here, the attribute 1 is able to discern between this object pair, this object pair, this object pair, and this object pair. So in total, 4 out of these 6 object pairs are being discerned by the first attribute. Then the fifth attribute is present. The fifth attribute is able to add to this object pair. This is able to add this object pair. So CV is now 5. And this eighth attribute is adding no further information. So CV is 5 in this case. So we compute here the first objective function as n is 8, the total number of attributes. So 8 minus 3 by 8, which is this. And F2 is 5 divided by 2 into 3, that is 6. So this is this. So this is how the encoding is done and the objective optimization is done. So this is the data set, the three data sets that we used. We used the colon cancer, lymphoma and leukemia. These are publicly available over the internet. And as you observe, the initial set of attributes, they're quite large corresponding to the number of samples. Here there were cancerous tissues and normal tissues having 40 samples, 22 samples, whereas the number of genes was 2000. Here, lymphoma, there were two types of lymphoma, 54 and 42 samples and 4026 attributes or genes. And in leukemia, ALL and AML, 47 and 25, and these are the number of genes. Now, we did some pre-processing and we reduced them to these values. And after that, when we used single objective genetic algorithm and RAF sets, these were the reduced set of attributes we obtained. And when we used the proposed method, the method that we used, the multi-objective genetic algorithm for optimization with RAF sets, we could reduce, you observe, from 2000 to 9, 4000 to 2, and 7000 to 2 with similar classification performance. So this is one sample result for the colon cancer data. Here the graph is provided for the single objective optimization and the multi-objective optimization. So with reduced number of attributes, we applied the k-nearest neighbor classifier and the performance was always higher. And this is the Pareto optimal front obtained for the colon data. This is only a one sample data. I won't go into the other details because of repetition as we move on to the next application. So we used a similar approach for face recognition. This was also a collaborative project with an industry in Kolkata, that is CDAC. And this was published in this journal in 2010. So here the problem was formulated in terms of elastic bunch graph matching. And the face was represented as a labeled graph with nodes, which were the fiducial points on the face, the important features of the face, like the nose, the eyebrow, lips, and all that. These were labeled by the Gabor wavelet responses, locally bundled in jets. So as a result, we had discrete set of 5 different spatial frequencies at 8 orientations of the face, and they were used at 14 fiducial points marked on the face. And in all, we had a total of 560 features to start with for each face. This is the schematic diagram. So this is the face. These are the low frequency Gabor wavelets, high frequency Gabor wavelets. And these are the wavelets of higher frequencies at same set of orientation. And this is the jet, the representation of the jet. And these are the different fiducial points on the face each having a jet there. So there were total of 560 features. So then we used a similar approach to the bioinformatics or the gene expression data approach that we used in there. So we used redux and we used multi-objective genetic algorithm to reduce the features in this face recognition problem. And this is the data set from Ferret, which is available on the internet, and this is the data set generated by our collaborator, that was CDAC. That is the Indian faces, and these are European and well, non-Indian faces probably. So the face region was extracted, then these are the fiducial points along the eyebrow, the middle of the eyebrow, eye, nose, teeth, lips, and in this manner we have 14 fiducial points, and the features in terms of Gabor wavelets were extracted. So this is a sample result. Here the data set was partitioned into four subsets, and in each case from the 560 we could reduce it by this algorithm to obtain 297, 300, 299, 305 similar. Now in the original space the accuracy was like this, but by the use of rough sets and multi-objective optimization in the reduced space the classification accuracy went up higher. So you see this is the utility of the method at higher efficiency because the size was smaller. So this is about the recognition results. So in this first example, there were four images per person in the database, and with this query image, we tried to retrieve the top 10 images. Now you see the images in the database are at slightly different orientations. So then it could extract the top 10 features, top 10 images extracted were these, and you see that it was mostly correct. Then with the Ferret database, again with 4 images per person, this was the result of this query. Next we move to 1 image per person. So with 1 image per person, this was the query image and this was the top 5 images extracted. Again this was the query image and these are the top 5 images extracted. Then this was based on the redact approach or the decision set theoretic approach, these applications. And now the final application is to using the RAF fuzzy clustering, the clustering based approach, and it was applied to medical imaging. This was based on a work that we did with Professor Vidur Pedridge of Canada. The basic RAF fuzzy algorithm was based on that, and we applied it to medical imaging. So, the first work on RAF CMeans was by Pawan Lingras, then a refinement was proposed by Professor Georg Peters, and then our algorithm, the RAF fuzzy CMeans, was done with Pedridge and my student Haider Banka. It was published in 2006, and based on that we applied it, we had this application. So to recollect, the RAF CMeans, when it is closest to one of the cluster centers, you assign the new, when it is very close to one cluster and not so close to the other, you assign it to the lower and upper approximation of this cluster. Otherwise, if they are close enough to both, you assign it to the upper approximation of both these clusters. So based on that, we designed the RAF fuzzy CMeans, which was published in 2006. So the basic algorithm is like this. So when it is neither the lower approximation nor the region between the lower and upper approximation, none of them are null, then we have these two components in the computation of the mean. Otherwise you have only either the first component or the second component. This is the basic of RAF fuzzy clustering. without going into the mathematical details, let's move on to the application. So in the application, we used it for synthetic as well as CT scan images of the brain. Now, rough fuzzy clustering is simultaneously able to handle overlap of clusters, which is because of the fuzziness in it, and the uncertainty involved in the class boundary, which is because of the roughness in it. And the number of clusters was optimized using cluster validity indices, and the main objective was the diagnosis of the extent of brain infarction in the CT scan images. So first, the synthetic data, we generated 32 points with two clusters. There were three outliers to test the ability of the algorithm to resist a bias in the estimation of the cluster prototypes, and we provide the results obtained by the hard c-means, fuzzy c-means, rough c-means, and the rough fuzzy c-means. So this is the picture of the data set that was generated. So you see these are the three outliers, and they try to influence the positioning of the cluster centers. They pull them up. So we experimented with the robustness of the algorithm to the existence of outliers. So these are some of the results with hard C means. These red rectangles represent the cluster centers obtained. You see it has been moved up away from the actual center. With fuzzy C means it was better. With only rough C means it was again a little bit disturbed, but with rough fuzzy C means this was found to be the best in terms of the validity indices that we computed. So the clustering validity indices used were Davis-Boldin, Z-Benny, and Z-Weight index. Now Davis-Boldin gives the minimum value for the best clustering, Z-Benny gives the minimum value for the best clustering, and Z-Weight index gives the maximum value for the best clustering. And in all three cases, the rough fuzzy algorithm was able to generate the best quantitative measure. With that, we move to the real-life data from the CT scan. Now, segmentation is the process of partitioning an image into some non-overlapping meaningful regions. Here, the segmentation was done via pixel clustering. And the study consisted of cases of vascular infarction of the human brain. The human brain, the infarction, the vascular infarction means how the blood spills into the certain region due to some physiological problems. So we partitioned the brain region into five regions: the gray matter, white matter, the infarcted region, the skull, and the background. This is the image, the fresh case of vascular insult. This is the original image, and you can see that the infarction is on the left side. This is how it has got swollen this side. Actually the brain is symmetrical, but here due to the blood seeping in, it has gone this way. It has swelled this side. The left side is compressing the right side. The dilation of the blood ventricles. These are all the medical terms we learned from the medical expert. There is severe edema or swelling, and the division of the brain was made into gray matter, white matter, and the cerebrospinal fluid. This is the cerebrospinal fluid. The third ventricle is not visible here due to severe edema from the right ventricle side, and the main cause of this is cholesterol deposit and blockage. So this is the segmentation we obtained with our algorithm. So the infarcted region, the white matter, the cerebrospinal fluid, and the gray matter. This is a comparative study of the four algorithms: hard c-means, rough c-means, fuzzy c-means, and the rough fuzzy c-means. And we consulted the radiologist, who said that the rough fuzzy c-means resulted in better segmentation of the white matter, gray matter, and the cerebrospinal fluid. This is another sample image of chronic infarction. Here also a similar situation is arising. This happens due to normal old age. the arteries were blocked due to high cholesterol levels, and these are all medical terms. And this was the segmentation result we obtained, and we were able to correctly segment the infarcted region of the brain. And this is a third case. Here it is also caused by cholesterol deposit and blockage. And these are all the medical terminology associated with this case. And this corresponded to the segmentation results we obtained. There is uniform merging of gray matter in the infarcted region in this case. And this is the white matter. And it was studied, and the results were verified by an experienced radiologist. The rough fuzzy scenes was stated to produce the best result, as verified by the expert radiologist. And the results promised to provide a second opinion to radiologists in case of computer-aided diagnostics. So, to summarize, we have discussed the use of rough sets in feature selection and classification, then in rough and rough fuzzy clustering, with applications to microarray gene expressions, face recognition, and rough fuzzy segmentation for CT scan images of the brain. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your patience.
Well, taking a question concerning machine learning. So you mentioned we're using the multi-objective genetic algorithm, and I guess that was kind of your version or your variant of the algorithm. But do you have any use, for instance, the MSGA by then?
In our algorithm, we have NSGA at the base, of course. NSGA that was developed in a different manner. But any multi in this aspect, I can stress that any multi-objective optimization can do. We have used genetic algorithm as a tool. Any other algorithm could be used, but multi-objective optimization should be used because these are conflicting criteria.
Yeah, of course, if you want to avoid going. And the other question, if I may, is a little more general. Is, you know, in the applications where you rely on reacts. You know,
yes.
And we know that we have a problem of quite often obtaining many reacts from the same data set. Some of them may have the same size. And the question is, which of them should be picked? Do you have any, you know, experience or I would say, hints to what measures what can be used to possibly differentiate, you know, the reacts that are apparently of the same quality?
Yeah, mathematically all of them are sufficient. Necessary and sufficient.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. So maybe each of them focus on a different region of the feature space, but what so to bring in the flavor of all of them, that is why we use genetic algorithm in a broader framework to concatenate. If you look at one, if you remember one of the earlier applications of the sub networks, we concatenated them together and then evolved them, keeping the internal structure intact with a lower mutation, but evolving the between sub network structure little bit. So by that we try to involve the flavor from all the regions of the space.
So a question regarding this gene expression analysis. So it struck me that we find very few genes.
Yes.
as a final solution. So is it a unique solution? Because, I mean, these are very important questions. What are the biomarkers, for example, selecting different types of leukemia? And if there were unique two genes or seven genes that are really separating very well patients of different kinds, I think this would have tremendous implications. And the question is, have you looked into what are these genes, if there's only just two, and whether they're really relevant for leukemia, or is this one of hundreds of equally well separating solutions?
What we tried to do was we computed the p-values, which is used in gene expressions. The p-value computes the goodness of that gene with respect to the problem. So we when one problem that we faced was the scarcity of information available, the biological information, because it is getting updated so frequently. So the genes we work with today, they upload some other information and the whole database changes. And also another major problem is interacting with people from different domains. So the computer scientists, the language of the computer scientists and the language of the biologists often do not match. So that is a major bottleneck that is faced. But what we tried to do was, with all the available information and literature over the internet, we tried to validate the results that we obtained in terms of the p-values, which gives a measure of how good that gene is, how good a set of genes are with respect to a cluster. So in that sense, we tried to validate, and that was used for, up to publishing the paper. But after that, the interaction that is really needed, maybe that is a stumbling block. Still, we need good collaboration.
Maybe I have one other general comment. It was last week we had a talk by Professor Nowinski from Singapore. He came just to Poland with more than 50 patents. Discovery of different kinds of brain atlases with the idea to create a neurotechnological center. Of course, he was blessed with handshaking by our president, premier, and all top people, but still without giving him a chance to open this center. It means without giving them money. What I'm saying is this, because I think that especially also in Poland, we have different groups of people distribute from, I think maybe even sometimes similar problems, but the future I think will depend if we will be able to concentrate a lot of teams around larger projects to have something like this. So also what I can see is your results related to other applications to the brain images analysis. So if only we will be lucky, most probably you will be very welcome to join this neurotechnological center. So one day this, our conversations will be blessed and they open their eyes and they will start to like the science. So this is my general remark. Some more questions or remarks? If not, I think we are very close to the final time. I would like to thank you very much for the very interesting talk, and I'm very glad that you came here, and I am sure that this cooperation will grow, and especially I would like to announce that in June next year, I'm going to convince the Warsaw University of Technology to organize a conference. This conference started by Professor Sankar Pal in Kolkata in India. This this training conference, pattern recognition and machine intelligence. So after many years, also going to different countries. Recently, I think it was in Moscow. So it was very lucky that it was before lockdown, because now it looks really again we have traveled together. So, but in June this conference in Warsaw, and so you are most welcome to come to cooperate. And also, we announced a special issue on the fundamental informatics on graph sets and fuzzy sets, because next year will be the 50 years of fuzzy sets. And being here, because here is a faculty full of theoreticians who are not accepting fuzzy sets in the theory. But I'm trying also to say that this was not created just to make a revolution in mathematics, but the language for modeling, and it was quite successful in many applications. And of course, when you have a mixture of inductive and deductive reasoning, it's not always you can prove beautiful theorems, but you can have a very good applications and results. So, just this is also a proper thank you. Let's, I think, thank one.